This here is an ESP8266, home to literally thousands of hobbyist projects and some more commercial ones. It's just amazing. People, it's been used in over 270 projects on Hackaday.io alone. So this little guy used to just be thought of something that could be a little more than a serial to Wi-Fi bridge. So you'd need something like an AVR to talk to it. But over time, people found out more and more about it, eventually able to program programs in C for it, and taking it steps further to be able to get access to the GPIO and some of the other peripherals like the PWM, the I2C, the SPI buses, even the SDIO bus. Everything about it is just insane. And it's just this awesome part that could do, well, what people thought could do almost anything, that is, except for talk Ethernet. And that is until today. So this little guy, although it does not have an Ethernet controller, despite my title, it does have an awesome I2S bus with DMA, which is how I actually told it to broadcast Channel 3 television. If you're curious about that, you can click on that video right here. At any rate, what it does is it can talk in and out of the chip at 40 megahertz. I can then digitize that, or not really digitize, it's digitized there. I can take that and I can hook it into a line driver here, hook it up to an Ethernet magnetics, and up to this Ethernet cable to this Ethernet switch. So even though the ESP was only ever really designed to connect by Wi-Fi, we've now added another interface. So it's hooked into my laptop here, and in the browser, I can visit its fixed IP. It's currently sitting at 10.1.10.5. Let's view that. And it loads this web page. It's a lot like the other WebSockets pages. If you're curious about how these WebSockets interfaces work, you can click on this video right here. At any rate, we can actually see that it's getting communications to and from the ESP8266 at around 700 Hz. That means that this web page is creating a new request going to the ESP8266. The ESP8266 is responding, going back to the web page, and all of that is able to happen at 700 Hz. That involves all of the ACKs, all of the requests, all of everything in TCP. Unlike the other demos, it has a new feature on this web page here. The feature is called Last Packet. What I can do is I can go open this tab and I can get a packet. Now, if you're curious, you can actually visit this web page online on the on the GitHub IO page in the description, and we can go load a test packet and you can go play with that. You can go set some bits high or low or whatever. You can even like break it so that it goes, oh, I can't decode that packet. On here though, I can click get another packet and it will actually get the last packet on the line. So I used this interface for debugging it when I was trying to figure out how I was going to interpret these raw packets. They're just the raw Manchester encoded packets. I don't go into much detail on how all of this works on this video, but for a lot more technical information, you can either check out the GitHub or the Hackaday article linked in the description. It's great, it goes into a lot more detail about how all of this fits together. This is more of a video just showing you how it all, like, works. So this right here is the web page that's being served from the ESP over to here. I can do crazy things like even reflash the ESP through the Ethernet just by net flashing it. For right now though, let's take a look at what kind of performance it can get. So I'm going to go ping it at 0.02 second intervals. And these are relatively small pings, but as you can see, it's keeping up. And much to my surprise, it's actually getting a lot of packet throughput. In fact, there hasn't been a drop packet yet. The average ping response time is 0.85 milliseconds. That is all the way from my laptop to the switch into the ESP, decoding the packet, checking the CRC, then opening it up, realizing it's a ping packet, dealing with the ping packet, responding to the ping packet, packaging it back up, calculating the frame CRC, Manchester encoding it, shifting it out the register, and then going back into the switch, into my laptop, all of that in one, I don't know, maybe that's 1/1200th of a second. So it's not just little packets that this thing can respond to. It can respond to full size packets. Let's try sending it 1200 bytes of ping. Now, it's a little bit slower. You can see that it's down to 3.8 milliseconds average, but it's still able to keep up, and it's able to respond to these ridiculous packages. This really isn't something you would want to use in a serious project. It's much more of a circus trick, like using an FTDI chip or something. Just don't use them in any kind of commercial product. You really shouldn't be using this either. And it's kind of janky. It's just not done well, right. You really should be using a PHY and a Mac and everything else, but it's fun, and this totally would work for hobbyist projects. It just wasn't janky enough, though. So, for maximum jank, I have here the same sort of getup, except it's just with a Node MCU board, and it's hooked up with some LEDs and other stuff, and I have it going through some capacitors and resistors right into an Ethernet cable. Let's get this thing plugged up right now. Here I am now. There's a little breadboard with the ESP on it. And it's plugged up to the switch, and yes, it's linking. So this is without magnetics, without, you know, much of anything. Just two resistors and two capacitors hooked into the ESP. This too is able to communicate by Ethernet. Now, you may notice that the packet loss is significantly worse. Even though the average packet time is only 0.85 milliseconds, we're talking about packet loss in the 60-70% range. It's just plain awful. There's an interesting thing going on here, though, and a lot of this is actually due to a whole lot of high-frequency noise going on the line, and nothing really there to clean it up and absorb the higher frequency noise, so it just corrupts the packets. In fact, it's so bad right now that it, now it's back. All I have to do, though, is if I plug in this little length of wire here, so got this wire, green wire, and this awful thing. If I plug this in to the line on the processor, you'll see that it gets much better. That's because instead of the signal, the high frequency noise, going and just messing up our signal, it can actually be just radiated into the atmosphere where it's somebody else's problem to deal with. That way, I just don't have to worry about it. So I strongly do not recommend using this kind of thing, also because there's no galvanic isolation, and that's kind of dangerous unless you know that all of your grounds are the same. But it works. And it's just insane how this little ESP8266 can go and actually talk Ethernet. Oh, well, I hope you guys like this. Check me out on check out the Hackaday article, and check out all the source code is available in GitHub. And I hope that I can find some people to help maintain this project and maybe port it to other things and do something else interesting with it. Thanks.